In this problem, we're doing one-dimensional kinematics, but we have two moving objects. So the diagram gets a little bit complicated. At t equals 0, car A is going through the origin at 32 meters per second. And car A moves with constant velocity. So it's a very simple motion. It just keeps going at 32 meters per second. At the same moment in time, car B starts from rest, and it accelerates in the positive direction with a constant rate of 8 meters per second squared. So car B starts from rest, car A blows right by it, and then car B just speeds up and speeds up and speeds up and eventually goes zooming past car A. And we're trying to find the position where that occurs. We're trying to find the time where that occurs, and we're trying to find the speed of car B when it goes zooming past car A. So the first step in a problem like this is to be able to mathematically describe the position of each car as a function of time. And this just goes back to our standard kinematics equations. So our first sort of fundamental kinematics equation is x equals x naught plus v naught t plus 1/2 at squared. Each of these cars has a constant acceleration, so they each obey an equation like this, describing their position as a function of time. For part D, we're going to need the second fundamental kinematics equation, so I may as well write it down right now. V equals V naught plus AT. So in part A, we're asked for the position as a function of time for each car, and it's really just this first equation of motion that I wrote down. Each of them has an initial position of 0, and if I start working on car A, it has an initial velocity of 32 meters per second. Notice I skipped the x naught term because it's located at 0 when t is 0. And car A has an acceleration of 0 as well. So we're done. That's the position as a function of time. Car B is a little more complicated. It also starts at x equals 0. So that term is gone. It has an initial velocity of 0. So that term is gone. But it has a non-zero acceleration. So that term survives. The acceleration is 8. So I get 1/2 times 8 times t squared, which I can simplify then to 4t squared. So there's my two functions that describe the position of these cars as a function of time. That allows me to answer part B, compute the time at which car B passes car A. And the key to this is to say, well, when car B passes car A, the two cars are in the same place at the same time. So I just set those two position functions equal to each other, and I ask, what time is it? So I get 32t is equal to 4t squared. I can cancel a t out of this, but I want to point out that when I do that, I'm eliminating one of the solutions to this quadratic equation. T equals 0 is a solution. And the reason why is there's two different times where the two cars are in the same place. One of them, of course, was at t equals 0. That's where the problem started. And then the one I really am interested in is the other one. So we can go ahead and cancel out that extraneous solution. Dividing by 4, I end up with t equals 8 seconds. In part C, I'm asked to get the position at which car B passes car A. And you can plug into either one of these position functions to get that done. And it's actually wise to do both of them just to make sure the answers agree. So if I look at the position of car A when t is 8 seconds, I get 32 times 8. And that's 256 meters to the right of the origin. When I look at car B, I better get the same answer. And that's also 256 meters to the right of the origin. So we verified these two cars really are in the same place when t is equal to 8 seconds, so that's good. Finally, we're asked to compute the speed of car B when it passes car A. So this is where we use the second basic kinematics formula, v equals v naught plus at. And I subscripted all those quantities with a b because that's the car we're talking about. And I'm interested in its final velocity when t is equal to 8, and the initial velocity was 0. The acceleration is 8 meters per second squared. The time it was accelerating for is 8 seconds. And I get 64 meters per second. If you find the physics content on Zach's Lab helpful, click on the Zach's Lab logo on the right to browse playlists and subscribe to the channel. I produce over 100 new videos per month, and subscribing is the easiest way to find new content. Thanks for watching.